Oh, the new boss is going to be here soon. I hope nothing goes wrong.
You better watch out, Colin. I heard she's got big plans for this place.
Hey, lads, is the new boss here yet? I want to show her my magic jumping beans. Look at him.
I think she's coming.
Yes, Miss Hucklebuck here. No, just arriving now. It seems to be some sort of TV studio.
Positions, please, everyone.
I don't have a clue either.
This is Brain Freeze with Doctor Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin the floor manager, and Miss Hucklebuck. Stand by!
Today we're asking, which animal can jump the farthest?
The animal kingdom is full of some incredible jumpers.
Tell me, which one can hop the highest, huh?
Amongst mammals, the clipspringer can jump the highest relative to its own body size. This small African antelope is able to jump 10 times its own height. The mammal that can jump the farthest relative to its own body size is the kangaroo rat. It's able to jump 45 times its own length.
That's amazing. 45 times. I wonder how high I can jump.
No, I don't think there's much going on here, actually. I can't seem to see anything happening.
Oh, how unprofessional. I think it's time for a break.
And we're clear. This is the brilliant Dr. Knowles, our head of research and development.
Pleased to meet you, Miss Hucklebuck.
Hello, yes.
Oh, yes, and this is Professor McCork. He's a scientist too, sort of.
How's it going, boss? Do you want a magic bean?
Oh, jumping beans.
Hey, come back here, you.
Oh, crumpets. Positions!
Today's big answer!
So tell us, Dr. Knowles, which animal can jump the farthest?
Jumping spiders can jump 100 times their own body length. Tree frogs can jump 150 times their own body length. And fleas can jump 220 times their own body length.
Wow, nothing could beat that, could it, Dr. Knowles? Nothing.
Well, actually, there is one creature. A tiny crustacean called a copepod can accelerate to a speed of 500 body lengths per second when it's performing an escape jump. That's the equivalent of a human underwater propelling themselves over 800 meters in 1 second.
Unbelievable.
So now you know, folks, the tiny copepod is by far nature's best jumper. See you next time.
Oh, McCork, you've done it again!
Yeah, sorry about that, Colin. Still, though, they brightened the place up a lot, don't you think?
Oh, this is not a good start on Miss Hufflepuff's first day.
Chin up, Colin. Who knows? Maybe she likes jumping beans.
Oh, crumpet!
Jonathan! You're a hard worker, a real wizard with a vacuum cleaner. But can I really trust you to hit your targets? You there, you seem to know about science and things, but I'm looking for someone who can really fly. I'm just not sure you're that person. And then there's you, McCork. Erratic, unpredictable, perhaps even a genius.
A genius?
So, I've come to my decision. Professor McCork, you are going to be fired.
Fired? Really? Oh, no.
Oh, crumpets.
Positions, everybody.
This is Brain Freeze with Dr. Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin the floor manager, and Miss Hufflepuff. Stand by!
It's time for
today's big question!
Today we're asking, What is a shooting star?
Our solar system today is full of planets, moons, asteroids, and small worlds of dust and ice called comets. Most comets have huge elliptical orbits, but when they come near the sun, heat melts the ice, and they grow long tails of gas and dust.
But what do these comets have to do with shooting stars?
When the ice in a comet's trail melts, it releases small chunks of rock and dust into space. These and other small rocky particles hurtling through space are known as meteoroids. And when they enter the Earth's atmosphere, they're known as meteors.
So, they're not really stars at all?
Don't forget, McCork! My office, 5 p.m. Don't be late!
But we're live! Oh, that is so unprofessional!
Go to ad break! Ad break now!
I'm really going to miss you, McCork. So many memories.
Positions! Get off, McCork!
Aw, it's just not going to be the same without him.
What are you talking about?
Positions, everyone!
Today's big answer!
So, if they're not shooting stars, then what are they?
Entering the Earth's atmosphere at speeds of 15 kilometers per second, meteors heat up rapidly due to friction with the air. As they burn up, they glow brightly, creating the streak of light we see as shooting stars.
That's amazing!
At certain times of the year, when Earth passes through a stream of dust left by a passing comet, we can see meteor showers, spectacular events with up to 50 shooting stars per minute.
50 per minute? That's an awful lot of stars.
Aw, none of them are as bright as you, Professor.
Ah, stop it. You're only embarrassing me now. See you around, everyone.
And we're clear.
What the?
Hey, looks like I'm getting fired, all right. From a cannon.
Welcome, everybody, to my annual charity, Fire a Colleague from a Cannon Challenge.
This is absolutely bonkers!
Ready, McCork?
Ready as I'll ever be, Mrs. Hucklebunyip.
Here we go. 3, 2, 1. Whoopsie! I think I might have got the calculations a bit wrong there.
Oh, it's going to be a long year.
How can Miss Hucklebuck have so much stuff?
Maybe she just really likes boxes.
I wish she liked smaller boxes.
Jonathan, can you pop upstairs, please? My telephone doesn't seem to be working. Hello?
Oh, will do, Miss Hucklebuck. And by the way, my name is Colin. Positions, everyone!
This is Brain Freeze with Doctor Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin the Floor Manager, and Miss Hucklebuck. Stand by!
Come on, everybody!
It's time for today's big question!
Today we're asking, what is the world's strongest natural material?
Strength can be measured in a number of ways. Diamond is the hardest natural material and is very difficult to scratch. However, if you smash a diamond with a hammer, it will fracture. On the other hand, super strong steel is known for its amazing tensile strength, meaning it can resist being pulled or stretched. But there are some materials in nature that are even stronger.
What?
Spider silk has incredible tensile strength, and relative to its size, is actually stronger than steel.
Whoa, that's amazing. There couldn't be anything stronger than that.
I wouldn't be so sure. See you after this break.
And we're clear!
Really, what's in these things?
Yeah, I've got my suspicions about this one, all right.
Hello! Hello, Miss Hucklebuck! It's Colin here! Well, I did not expect to see that.
Wait till the others find out about this.
Oh, crumpets. Positions!
Today's big answer!
So tell us, Dr. Knowles, what is the world's strongest natural material?
The world's strongest natural material isn't diamond.
No.
Or steel.
No.
Or even spider silk.
Oh, please tell us. Please tell us, Dr. Knowles.
It's limpet teeth.
Limpet teeth? Limpet? Teeth? That's a joke, right?
Limpets are a type of sea snail that look like barnacles. They feed on algae by scraping along rock surfaces with a tongue-like structure called a radula. Their radula contains tiny microscopic teeth, which are made of composite fibers that are both hard and tough, making for a phenomenal grip. By studying these incredible creatures, scientists are learning new ways to build structures in the human world. This process is called bio-inspiration.
Bio-inspiration. That's brilliant. We can all learn something from that.
See you next time.
Bye-bye, limpet fans.
Ugh, I feel like I'm going round in circles here. I could have sworn I carried this box in already.
Oh, I know what you mean, Doctor. It feels very repetitive.
Hang on. I've been moving all these boxes from here to there.
And I've been moving all those boxes from there to here.
Oh, don't tell me.
Oh, afraid so, Dr. Knowles. Sorry.
Oh, it's gonna be a long night.
Jonathan, you will keep it to yourself about, you know, what you saw earlier, won't you?
Absolutely, Miss Hucklebuck. Mum's the word.
Oh, and would you be a dear and pop back up when you get a sec? My computer seems to be running a bit slow.
Oh,
I have really tried to do everything.
Yes, Miss Hucklebuck.
I can't be the only person feeling this cold. Colin, what's going on?
Miss Hucklebuck won't turn the heating on. She says she doesn't feel the cold.
Ice pops for everyone. 99s, chilly willies, shivery jaws.
Really? In this cold?
Positions, everybody!
This is Brain Freeze with Dr. Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin, the floor manager, and Miss Hufflepuff. Stand by!
Time for
today's big question!
Today we're asking, where is the coldest habitable place on Earth?
Humans are most comfortable at temperatures between 20 and 26 degrees Celsius, or room temperature. We all know that the boiling point of water is 100 degrees, and its freezing point is 0 degrees.
Whoa, that's quite a drop.
But did you know that shampoo freezes at minus 3 degrees, sunflower oil at minus 17, and mercury at minus 39?
And if you thought that was cold, did you know that the lowest temperature ever recorded on Earth was 93 degrees below zero?
It's true. This record low was measured in a shallow pocket just off a high ridge on the East Antarctic Plateau.
Oh, that sounds like a pretty chilly place to live.
Oh no, it's way too cold for anyone to live there. If you exposed your skin, it would freeze in seconds. To find out about the coldest habitable place on Earth, join us after this break.
And we're clear!
Do you know what I have to say, Colin? This is a great way to keep your old hands warm.
What is wrong with everyone here? Do I have to do everything myself?
Hello? Hello?
Yes?
Miss Hucklebuck, I demand that you turn on the heating. My legs are about to freeze.
What's that, dear? You lost your keys?
No, no.
Your cat's got fleas?
No.
Ah, you want some cheese? Why didn't you say so?
Cheese? What the?
There we go.
No, what?
Today's big answer!
So tell us, Dr. Knowles, where is the coldest habitable place on Earth? Apart from here, obviously.
In the past, the two Siberian towns of Oymyakon and Verkhoyansk have both measured temperatures of a bone-chilling minus 67.8 degrees.
Oh, but how would you stay warm there?
The trick is to dress yourself like an onion.
Like an onion?
The more thin layers of air you trap between your body and the outside, the warmer you will get.
I get it. Not literally a boiled bunion.
No, Professor. See you next time, folks.
Hey, Dr. Knowles, come here. Look what we finished. You have to see this.
Oh, what is it now? Guys!
And there's room for one more.
Oh, go on then.
You're taking on the sleeve.
Oh, stop! I want to go this way.
I want to go over this way.
Ah, it's these tender moments that make it all worthwhile.
Oops, maybe that was a bit too tender.
What you making there, Colin?
It's my famous homemade carrot and ginger jam. Miss Hucklebuck's been under the weather all week. I'm hoping it'll make her feel better.
Best of luck with that.
Help! Happy harvest, everyone! Hello? Hello? Hello?
This is Brain Freeze with Dr. Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin the Floor Manager, and Miss Hufflepuff. Stand by!
Come on, everybody!
It's time for
today's big question!
Today's question is, will carrots turn me orange? Huh?
When we think of carrots, we picture the classic orange vegetable. But did you know that they used to be purple?
A purple carrot? Yuck!
Before the 16th century, cultivated carrots came in a mix of colours. But Dutch farmers took mutant strains of the purple variety and developed them into the sweet, plump, orangey ones we know today.
But tell me, Doctor, what's a carrot made of?
Carrots are full of vitamin A, vitamin K, vitamin C, vitamin B, vitamin E.
Yeah, so all of them, basically.
As well as potassium, fibre, phosphorus.
Yeah, okay, loads of vitamins, we get it. Oh, I think we need to take a break.
Okay, everybody, take five.
Yes?
Sorry to disturb, Miss Hucklebuck. I just thought I'd bring you this gift.
A gift? Be right there. Oh, jam.
Thoughtful?
How thoughtful? Yes, that's a word, yes. Sorry, Jonathan.
Oh, my name is Colin, actually. Oh, crumpet! Positions!
Today's big answer!
So tell me, Dr. Knowles, will carrots turn me orange?
Carrots contain a molecule called carotene, which gives the carrot its orange colour. Too much carotene in your body can lead to discoloration of the skin, a condition known as carotenemia.
Carotenemia? That sounds awful. Will I get that if I eat carrots?
Don't panic, Professor. You would need to eat enormous amounts of carrots for this to happen.
Sounds like a challenge to me.
And even if you did turn a bit orange, it wouldn't do you any harm.
So, there you have it, folks. Carrots can turn you orange.
Sometimes we really are what we eat.
Which would explain why I'm looking more and more like a potato.
See you next time.
Let's
get this harvest party started.
Whoa! I never knew harvest was this dangerous.
Well, Colin, how did your jam go down with Mrs. Hucklebuckle? Did she throw it back in your face?
McCork, be careful!
Oh, don't worry, Colin. It's party time!
Get up and have a dance.
Whee! I've forgotten how much I love dancing!
And I've just remembered why dancing is not allowed in the studio! No, not allowed.
Ah, please, Colin, just give us one peek inside.
Yeah, please! We've never even seen her office.
Security system activated.
Look, you two, Miss Hucklebuck is a very busy woman. You are not to enter. Understood?
Hooray! Woohoo! Hooray!
Doesn't sound like she's that busy.
Oh, come on, we've got a show to do.
What do you reckon, Professor?
This is Brain Freeze with Dr. Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin the Floor Manager, and Miss Hufflepuff. Stand by!
Come on, everybody!
It's time for
today's big question!
Did you hear what asking? What is the world's most venomous animal?
Venomous animals differ from poisonous animals in that they inject their toxin directly into their victim by means of a bite or sting. These animals include the Brazilian wandering spider, the most venomous spider in the world, the cleverly camouflaged stonefish, whose venomous spines can rot human flesh. And then there's the king cobra, which can spit venom into the eyes of its victims. A single bite can contain enough venom to kill an elephant.
He's very rude, that fella.
Back after these.
And we're clear!
Right, let's see how good Colin's system really is.
Password.
Open sesame?
How about password?
Oh, it could be anything. We'll never guess it.
Ah, crumpets.
Wow. Ha! That's it!
Still got it, Dr. Knowles.
Positions, everyone!
Time to go.
Hello? A little help here.
Today's big answer!
So tell us, Dr. Knowles, what is the world's most venomous animal?
The box jellyfish is generally regarded as the world's most venomous creature. Its venom is so overpoweringly painful that some victims go straight into shock and die of heart failure within minutes.
Oh, so is there anything good about venom at all?
Actually, there is. By studying venom, doctors have copied how it works in order to create new medicines. Venoms are really good at working fast and targeting specific areas, which is exactly what doctors need when treating patients.
Now that is deadly.
See you next time, folks. Come on, let's go.
Crumpets.
Help!
Wow, this is incredible.
Did you know about this all along, Colin?
Miss Hucklebuck made me promise to keep it a secret, and I failed. Crumpets.
I have to say, Dr. Knowles, I never thought I'd see anything like this.
What'd you say, Professor? Will we go and join the fun?
You betcha. Hey!
Wait for me! Wait for me!
Storms. They're so exciting.
Oh, I just hope it doesn't knock the power out again, Doctor.
Not to worry, Colin. There's no chance of that happening.
Oh, Crumpet! How are we going to do the show?
Hey, how's it going, everyone? Look what happened to me. Whoa, and one for you. Oh, this is deadly.
Are you thinking what I'm thinking?
Position!
This is Brain Freeze with Dr. Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin the Floor Manager, and Miss Hufflepuff. Stand by!
Come on, everybody!
It's time for
today's big question!
Today we're asking, how does lightning work?
Lightning is a giant spark of electricity usually created inside a cloud during a thunderstorm. Cold air containing ice crystals and hot air containing water droplets come into contact, creating a buildup of electrical charge. When the negative charge at the bottom of the cloud builds up, it will do everything in its power to connect with a positive charge elsewhere. It can find this positive charge above or below. resulting in spectacular lightning strikes.
Ha! I love it! Kazam! Take that! Boom!
It's becoming a little charged in here, too. I think we need a break.
And we're clear!
Oh, battery's dead. Professor, would you mind charging this?
Not a problem.
Yes, and my phone too.
There you go.
Oh, and be a dear McCork and blend my smoothie.
Oh, yeah.
And this radio is a bit dead. And I've got so much other things. I've got a hoover that I need you to have a look
this
at.
This is fantastic. It's not really free working. Power.
It might be free, but it won't last.
Uh-oh. No more power.
Lucky I built this backup generator. It's time to start pedaling. Position!
Today's big answer!
So what about this one, Dr. Knowles? Is it true that lightning never strikes twice?
With an estimated 8 million lightning strikes around the world every day, it certainly is possible that lightning can strike the same place more than once. These bolts heat the air, causing it to expand explosively before rapidly contracting as it cools. This causes the familiar crack and rumble we know as thunder.
But why does the thunder come after the lightning, so?
That's because light travels faster than sound. We see the lightning strike almost instantly, but it takes approximately 3 seconds for the sound to travel 1 kilometer. This way, we can calculate how far away the storm is by counting the time between lightning and thunder. 1, 2...
Yikes! This one's pretty near, so cool!
See you next time, everyone!
Well, I hope you lot learned something today.
Oh, we have, Colin. I'll never take electricity for granted again.
And you know, it's actually kind of fun without it.
Oh, look! The power's back on. Video games, anyone?
Yay! That's a video game.
Oh, Crumpet. Will we ever learn?
Oh! Oh, and Jonathan, while I'm at the optician's, can you water my plants, feed my fish, and would you be a dear and do my laundry?
I'll do my best, but there is only one of me, Miss Hucklebuck.
74, 75, 76, 77, 78.
Whoa, Professor! Even by your standards, this looks pretty bonkers.
It's my new homemade 3D printer. I'm using Mr. Quacker's here to make an army of rubber duckies.
Wow, that's actually pretty impressive.
87, 88, 89.
Going live in 5, everyone.
Ah, I'd better go and do the show.
This is Brain Freeze with Dr. Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin the Floor Manager, and Miss Hufflepuff. Stand by!
Come on, everybody!
It's time for
today's big question!
Today we're asking, is every human being unique?
The human body is made up of over 37 trillion tiny cells, and almost every one of them contains the set of instructions for making you. This instruction manual, or genetic code, is stored in our DNA, otherwise known as deoxyribonucleic acid.
Deoxypibalnukihukiwatnow.
Every living thing has DNA in its cells. Humans, bacteria, apples, chimpanzees.
Chimpanzees?
Believe it or not, human and chimpanzee DNA is nearly 99% similar.
Yeah, for some reason that doesn't surprise me.
In fact, all human DNA is almost 99.9% similar, and it's only in the tiny 0.1% where our genetic differences occur.
So there's your answer. Our DNA is always similar, but never exactly the same.
Well, not quite. There is one exception.
Huh?
Find out more after this break.
Maybe just a quick 40 winks.
Oh, better get back to the duckies. 105, 106, 107.
Hello, McCork.
Oh, hey, Colin. 108, 109.
Hello, McCork.
Yeah, I already said hello, Colin. 110, 111.
Hello, McCork.
Yeah, I heard you the first time, Colin. He's very friendly today, that's what.
Position is everywhere!
Crumpets!
Today's big answer!
So tell us, Dr. Knowles, are all human beings unique?
There is one exception, and that's in the case of identical twins. As we know, each egg or embryo has its own unique genetic code. But sometimes an egg splits in two. In this case, the resulting human beings are built using the exact same instruction manual.
So, are they the exact same in every way?
No. Their DNA is the same, but as they each have different life experiences, they will develop their own completely unique traits and personalities. See you next time! Okay, Professor, you really need to start thinking these inventions through a bit more.
Yeah, you're probably right. All the same, though, the place is going to be very clean.
Oh, hello, Jonathan. How do you like my new spectacle? Oh, I've seen double, triple double. Oh, Jonathan!
Miss Hucklebuck!
That's it! That's my lucky tennis ball!
Jonathan! It's Colin!
Oh dear.
It's not like Colin to be this late.
Maybe the pressure finally got to him and he gave up.
Help! I'm stuck in the pipes!
You're stuck in the pipes!
Positions.
This is Brain Freeze with Dr. Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin the Floor Manager, and Miss Hufflepuff. Stand by!
It's time for
today's big question!
Today we're asking, how does a compass work?
The first compass was invented in China during the Han Dynasty about 3,000 years ago. A compass is a lightweight magnet balanced on a pivot, which we call a needle. No matter where you stand on Earth, a compass will point towards the North Pole. For centuries, this simple piece of equipment helped seafarers navigate the globe and led to the Age of Discovery.
Speaking of discovery, we'd better go off and find Colin. See you shortly. And we're clear! I always wanted to say that.
Okay, Colin. I think I've got your location pinned down. What can you see in there?
I can see a T-junction up ahead. There's plenty of dust and cobwebs. And there's an awful lot of tennis balls. Get me out of here!
And we're live in 5, 4, 7, 33.
Today's big answer!
So tell us, Dr. Knowles, how on Earth does a compass work?
It's all because of the Earth's magnetic field. Convection currents in the liquid layers of the Earth's interior generate an electrical charge, a bit like a giant battery. Because the Earth rotates on its axis, this charge aligns itself with the Earth's poles, creating a positive charge at one end and a negative charge at the other, just like a magnet.
That's magnificent.
But did you know that there are actually two North Poles?
You what now? Two North Poles?
Because the Earth's magnetic field can vary, the exact location of magnetic north is always changing. Right now, it lies in northern Canada, about 1,600 kilometres from true north.
That must be very confusing for anyone living there.
So now you know how a compass works.
Well, hey! See you next time.
Please hurry up! I think I've got company!
Hang in there, Colin! We'll get you out soon!
Okay, if he bears 23 degrees...
I wonder what this big red button does. I probably shouldn't press it. Oh, I really want it. Oh, look! I just pressed it.
Whoa!
about you, McCork?
What can I say, Mrs. Hucklebadger? I do my best.
Oh, just typical.
30 seconds to air, everyone!
Professor, why do you keep buying all that old rubbish?
What do you mean, Dr. Knowles? A yellow rubber ducky, half a roller skate, giant underpants. It's hardly what you call rubbish. Uh-oh.
Oh, crumpets! Positions! Miss Hucklebuck!
This is Brain Freeze! With Dr. Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin the Floor Manager, and Miss Hucklebuck. Stand by!
It's time for
today's big question!
Today's question is, why do we cry?
There are three types of tears. Basal tears flow continuously throughout the day to keep our eyes from drying out. Reflex tears occur in response to irritants like dust or onions. And emotional tears occur in response to sadness, happiness, or physical pain. Tears are produced mostly by the lacrimal glands located just above the outer corner of each eye. They are usually swallowed or become part of the nasal fluid.
Which is why we get a runny nose when we cry.
Any excess tears spill from the lower eyelids in what we know as crying. On average, we produce over 110 litres of tears every year.
110 litres? Unbelievable.
See you after this break.
And we're clear.
Oh, you poor thing.
Oh, Jonathan.
Let it all out.
We had such good times together, me and Trampolina. Bouncing at the open, the tumble in the jungle, the prance in France. Now we'll never bounce together again.
Maybe an inflatable ducky would cheer you up. Huh?
Not now, McCork.
How about half a roller skate?
Stop it! Leave her be.
Hang on a minute. Can I see that box of junk again, Professor? I have an idea.
An idea? Oh, I love them things.
Places, everybody!
Today's big answer!
So tell us, Dr. Knowles, why do we cry?
Emotional crying is unique to human beings. It is thought to be a non-verbal way to communicate needs and to let others know when we are in distress. By letting other people know when we need help, we increase our chances of survival.
So, is crying good for us?
Just like laughing, crying is a critical part of human emotional makeup. Studies have shown that most people feel better after a good cry. So it's probably something we should all do now and again.
Did you hear that, Miss Hucklebuck?
See you next time, everyone! Hang on. I've nearly got it.
Really, Dr. Knowles? This is a kind of bonkers idea I'd come up with.
Well, it's our only shot. Whoa, that's it.
Nice job, Dr. Knowles. That actually looks pretty good.
Oh, hooray for you, McCork, and hooray for your gigantic pants.
Oh, there's a sentence I thought I'd never hear.
Oh, what? The underpants get the credit. Why do I bother?
And one more for when that lot's finished.
Aww. Yes, Miss Hucklebuck.
Toodle pip.
Oh, I don't know how you do this work, Colin. It's so boring.
Hey, everybody. Look what I got. Oh, you're gonna love this. There's no need to be scared, Dr. Knowles. They're only little mice.
It's not the mice that's the problem. It's the panpipes. I hate panpipes.
Going live in five, everyone.
This is Brain Freeze with Dr. Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin the Floor Manager, and Miss Hucklebuck. Stand by!
Come on, everybody!
question!
Today we're asking, why do cats purr?
There are two types of cats, those that purr and those that roar. The ones that roar generally belong to the larger species of cat, such as lions, tigers, leopards, and jaguars.
Oh my!
Those that purr include pumas, lynxes, cheetahs, bobcats, and of course our own domestic cats.
But how do they do it, Doctor?
Most scientists believe that purring begins in a cat's brain, which sends a signal to muscles in the voice box to vibrate. These muscles act like a valve by opening and closing the space between the vocal cords, allowing air to flow through the cat's voice box.
Hey, Dr. Knowles, how does a kitten learn to purr? Purractice? Do you get it?
Good one, Professor. See you after the break.
We're clear!
I mean, this isn't even part of my job. Oh, this day couldn't get any worse. Oh no! Not these guys again!
McCork, sort this mess out!
Ah, there they are. They keep escaping, honey.
Handpipes!
Positions, everybody!
Today's big answer!
So, Dr. Knowles, why do cats purr?
Cats usually purr when they're happy and content, like when they are resting, when they come into contact with people, and when they are eating.
But what does the purring do anyway, Doctor?
Well, there are a number of interesting theories. One suggests that it helps mother cats bond with their kittens.
Ah!
And it is also thought that purring may improve the cat's health.
Really? How so?
Some studies suggest that the purring sound occurs at a frequency that helps to improve bone density and healing.
What a perfect system. Did you get it, Dr. Knowles? A perfect system.
See you later, brain freezers.
Finally, all done.
And one more. Ciao.
What? But...
Hola!
Did you know?
I had a hunch, Mrs. Hucklepipes.
I think we'll have to have panpipes every day from now on.
Good morning, everyone.
Oh, this connection is so slow.
Tell me about it. Dr. Knowles, not impressed. Hashtag awkward.
Oh, really, you two? It's such a beautiful day, and you've got your head stuck on those things.
Ah, Jonathan. Selfie. Cheese.
Oh, not you as well, Miss Hucklebuck. Mm-hmm. Honestly, you're all turning into robots. Oh, sorry. No offence.
Oh, not the bell.
Oh, get to work, you lazy lot. We're live in 5, 4, 3.
This is Brain Freeze with Dr. Knowles. Professor McCork, Colin, the floor manager, and Miss Hufflepuff. Stand by!
Come on, everybody!
It's time for
today's big question!
Today we're asking, which animal has the best eyesight?
Like all mammals, human eyes consist of a pupil, which lets light in, a lens which focuses the light, and a retina on which the image is formed. But different animals process light in different ways. Human eyes are sensitive to the colours red, green, and blue. Some insects' eyes are sensitive to green, blue, and ultraviolet.
Ultraviolet? Cool!
And other animals like cats aren't very good at seeing in colour at all, but they can see really well in low light.
That must be handy when they're looking for their cat's pyjamas at night time.
Guess so. See you after this break.
Anyone for a game of tennis? So, I can't believe you're all still staring at those wretched screens. Right, that's it. I'm confiscating all electronic gadgets as of right now.
Hey, I need that.
Oh, Colin, how am I going to do my hashtags and the face plop?
Come on, you too, Miss Hucklebuck.
But, Jonathan...
No buts.
It's time to get back to the real world. We're going live!
Today's big answer!
So, Dr. Knowles, you were saying...
As we have seen, cats see well in low light, but they don't hold a candle to the tarsier.
Eh? What's a tarsier?
This small Asian primate has eyes that take up half the size of its head. They're so big they can't even move them.
Wow, look at them. He must be able to see really far with those whoppers.
Well, not really. Their night vision is exceptional, but they're not so great at distance. The animal with the sharpest vision is the eagle. When hunting, they can spot their prey from over 6 kilometers.
So, like, lots of animals have really good eyesight, but they all work a bit different.
Exactly. Different strokes for different folks.
See you next time, strokes. Oh, I mean folks.
And we're clear!
Oh, well, this is nice.
Oh, come on, Colin. Even you have to admit that this is really boring.
Mm-hmm. I beg your pardon?
I mean, look at the professor.
Oh, perhaps you're right. Okay, then. Maybe just one selfie?
Yay!
Say cheese.
Cheese!
Who's that? Cheese. Who said cheese?
Looking good, Professor. You're sure to win Beard of the Year with that.
Fat chance of that.
Wow. Now that's a beard.
Better luck next year, McCork. As if.
Well, someone seems a little overconfident.
Come on, let's do this. I've got a trophy to win.
This is Brain Freeze with Dr. Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin, the floor manager, and Miss Hucklebuck. Stand by!
It's time for
today's big question!
Today we're asking, why can't girls grow beards?
As children get older, their bodies begin to change during a time we call puberty. Around the age of 10 to 16, hormones called androgens cause body hair to become thicker and darker in both boys and girls. This happens more widely on the male body, especially on the chest, the upper lip, the face,
the ears, nostrils, along your back and shoulders, between your toes.
Well, some people are hairier than others, Professor. The truth is, it's different for everyone.
And isn't it great to be a bit different? See you after the break.
Back of the net.
Oh, what a lovely trophy. So shiny. What's it for, Jonathan?
Oh, it's nothing major. It's just this little competition that my family has won for the last 50 years.
Ha ha! Happy bearded year. He wins it every time.
Is that so?
Steady hand, nice and relaxed.
Oh, crumpets, no! My beautiful beard! Positions, everybody!
Today's big answer!
So tell us, Dr. Knowles, why can't girls grow beards?
In much the same way as lions and peacocks use hair and feathers to attract females, some believe men evolved to do the same with facial hair. Men produce 10 times more testosterone than women. This is the hormone that promotes hair growth.
So that's why men are hairier.
Exactly. In fact, if a man never, ever shaves his facial hair, it could grow up to 9 meters long during his lifetime.
Whoa, imagine. That'd be the beard of this century.
Higher levels of testosterone also result in men's greater upper body strength and deepened voices, but also a tendency towards more aggressive behaviour.
Us men can be right silly sometimes.
Yep, we can all be a bit silly now and then. See you next time!
And we're clear!
Na 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 na, I'm the only entrant, therefore I'm the winner.
Gracious as ever, McCork.
Woohoo! Late entrant for the competition. Where do I sign up?
But That's a fake beard from the joke shop.
We spent months growing these beards.
Yes, and so what?
Well, it says here, Professor, the overall winner shall be the person sporting the biggest beard. Sorry, it doesn't say that you have to grow it yourself.
Ah, crumpets!
Congratulations, Miss Hucklebook!
Oh, wonderful! Beard of the year! Oh, well, better luck next year, boys.
Do not overfeed the fish, do not overfeed the fish, do not overfeed the fish.
Cool! Who's your friend, Colin?
This is Miss Hucklebook's pet fish, Stephen. Apparently, he's very rare.
Aw, hi, Stephen. Hi.
Good morning, everyone. How are we all today?
Crumpets!
This is Brain Freeze! With Dr. Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin, the floor manager, and Miss Hucklebuck. Stand by!
Come on, everybody!
It's time for
today's big question!
Today we're asking, do goldfish have bad memories?
Goldfish are a type of carp and were one of the first fish to be domesticated about 1,000 years ago. We mostly think of them as being bright orange, but goldfish can also be yellow, red, brown, and black.
Yeah, but what's so special about goldfish anyway?
Goldfish don't have stomachs like ours, so they should only be fed in small amounts. They also produce a lot of waste, so it's very important that their water be kept clean. If properly looked after, goldfish can live for up to 40 years. In fact, the oldest goldfish on record lived to be 49.
Whoa, 49. That's even older than me.
More fishy science right after the break.
And we're clear.
Hello, hello.
Hello, Miss Hucklebutt.
Just checking in on how my little Stevie Weevy is doing.
Yes, yes, very well. We're taking good care of him.
Oh, I do wish I could have brought him with me. He's just not very keen on aeroplanes.
I look at you, you poor little thing. You're starving. She must never feed you. Here, have another hot dog.
You will promise to give him a big hug from me, won't you, Jonathan?
Absolutely, Miss Hucklebuck. The name's Colin, actually. Oh, McCork, what are you doing? He's not supposed to eat that.
What do you mean? Look at him, he's fierce happy.
Oh. Position!
Today's big answer!
So, Dr. Knowles, do goldfish have bad memories or what?
There is a common myth that goldfish only have a 3-second memory, but this is completely false. Goldfish are, in fact, much smarter than we think. Studies have shown that they actually have a memory span of at least 3 months.
3 months? Sure, I haven't a clue what happened 3 seconds ago.
What's more, goldfish can distinguish between different colours, shapes and sounds.
That's brilliant. Sure, I haven't a clue what happened 3 seconds ago.
See you next time. Oh, Colin, no!
I'm done for, Dr. Knowles. The boss will never stand for this.
I think he's gonna...
Or to what?
Wow. Just... wow.
Wow, indeed.
What a pong. Sorry about that, Stephen. Only fish food for you from now on.
I really hope you've learned your lesson this time, Professor.
Listen, sure I haven't a clue what happened 3 seconds ago.
30 seconds to air, everyone. All set, Dr. Knowles?
Well, I am, Colin, but someone's too busy playing with their silly new invention.
Excuse me, my state-of-the-art super shrinker is not silly. It's genius. Oh, hang on, I think it's jammed. Let me take a look here.
Positions, everybody!
This is Brain Freeze! With Dr. Knowles, Professor McCork,
the floor manager and Miss Hufflepuff. Stand by!
Come on, everybody!
Well, hey, it's showtime!
Today's big question!
Today we're asking, what is the largest animal of all time?
What the?
Millions of years ago, the Earth was ruled by dinosaurs, and to this day, they are still the largest land animals ever to exist.
T-Rex, was he the biggest?
Actually, no. The largest dinosaurs were herbivores, meaning that they only ate plants. These huge sauropods are thought to have measured up to 35 meters in length and weighed the same as 18 elephants.
But to find out what animal is even bigger than the dinosaurs, join us after this break.
McCork! McCork! Oh, there you are, McCork!
Ah! There's two giants on the loose! Help!
Right, I've almost fixed this thing. If I could just reverse the magnification.
Oh, Jonathan, look at the adorable little dolly!
Ah, put me down, I'm not a doll!
Your little arms and your little feet, you're so cute!
Oh no, what are we gonna do, Colin? The show's about to start!
Don't you worry, Dr. Knowles!
Huh?
We're live in 5, 4, 3...
Today's big answer!
So tell us, Dr. Knowles.
Camera 2, Colin?
So tell us, Dr. Knowles, what is the largest animal of all time?
Measuring up to 30 meters and weighing up to 180 tons, the blue whale is the largest animal on Earth. Everything about this animal is huge. Its heart is the size of a small car, and its tongue alone is so big, 50 people could stand on it.
Gosh, now that's big!
Blue whales are still on the endangered list, but their numbers are slowly recovering.
And it's our job as scientists to help ensure a future for this gentle giant of the ocean.
Boo!
Ah!
What do you mean, scientists? You're only the floor manager.
Oh, McCork, get off me head! Even when you're tiny, you're trouble. Get off me!
See you next time, I hope.
Let me go.
Well, McCork, that's enough of your tiny mischief. Let him have it, Dr. Knowles.
Oh, dear, I think I might have overdone the calculations.
Jonathan, have you seen my dolly? I can't find her anywhere.
How's it going, Mrs. Hockey Baby? Oh, look at the cute little dollies. Oh, they're so cutesy-wootsy.
Put me down! Put me down!
Oh, stop it! Stop it, McCork! That tickles! Ground control to Mission 1. Do you read me? Come in, please.
Mission 1 to ground control. Receiving you loud and clear.
Prepare to engage transmission. Oh, and by the way, Dr. Knowles, where on Earth is McCork?
That's the thing, Colin. I'm not on Earth at all.
I'm in space.
Wow. And we're live from space in 10, 9, 8, 7...
This is Brain Freeze with Dr. Knowles, Professor McCork, Colin the Floor Manager, and Miss Hufflepuff. Stand by!
3, 2, 1, it's time for...
Today's big question!
Welcome to Brain Freeze in space!
Today we're asking, what is a black hole?
To understand black holes, we first need to talk about gravity. Every object exerts a gravitational pull on every other, and the larger the mass of the object, the stronger the pull. We're all familiar with gravity on Earth.
It's what keeps us from floating away.
What goes up must come down.
In space, these gravitational forces keep the moon orbiting the Earth and the planets orbiting the sun.
So, what would it be like without gravity, Dr. Knowles?
Let's find out.
This is brilliant.
To find out what all this has to do with black holes, join us after this break.
Show's going well, Dr. Knowles.
windows. What's it like up there?
Oh, Colin, it's so beautiful. Looking back at planet Earth is truly amazing. Such a fragile world. So still, so silent, so perfect, huh?
Hey, Doctor, look at the way my snot behaves in zero gravity.
Professor!
Stupid gravity.
Stand by in space.
We're coming back to you live.
Today's big answer!
So tell us, Dr. Knowles, what is a black hole?
Black holes are not really holes at all. In fact, they're the opposite of empty.
They're full and a black hole.
A black hole is an area of such immense gravity that nothing, not even light, can escape from it. Black holes form when a star collapses in on itself, producing a massive explosion.
Boom!
All the material left over is thought to have a mass of more than 10 suns, which gets squashed into a sphere roughly the size of New York City.
It's so small now, and yet so big. I don't understand.
Imagine if the entire mass of the Earth was squashed down to the size of a fingernail.
That would be a lot of gravity.
It is. And that's why other smaller objects are pulled towards it and trapped inside.
Oh, I hope there are no black holes around here.
Not to worry, Professor. The nearest one is hundreds of light years away. I think we're pretty safe. See you next time.
Brain freeze from space, we are clear. Oh! Miss Hucklebuck? Miss Hucklebuck!
Dr. Knowles, what's that tiny dot there?
You mean the one heading straight for us?
Whoa!
Oh, hello there. Any chance of a lift home?
This is nuts!
She's bonkers, that one.